Everything's rolling. Action. What's up? My name is Bobby. I do all the production for Dreamer Boy. And today I want to talk about our new single, Know You. It was also mixed by Jeff Ellis, assistant Nathan Phillips, and mastered at Sterling Sound by Adam Grover. So I have all the versions we've ever made of it pulled up right here. Hang on, my roommate's doing laundry. I'm gonna go turn that off real quick. That was driving me crazy. Okay, I wanted to walk you guys through some of the older versions of this song because I feel like that's the most important part to me of understanding a finished product is understanding the process of building it. And then once we do that, we'll actually pull apart the session and I'll show you some of the fun stuff that's going on in there. This is the bounce of a file that was created in May 2018. We were wrapping up the Dreamer Boy album, the first one, Love Nostalgia. We were working on the last song, which is called Dreamer. There was this vocal stem from it. I'll actually show you the section of the song. In the right summer. We were trying to make a pad that would fit in Dreamer, and something I like doing is making pads out of vocals. So we extracted that ooh, and I started looping it and playing that on a keyboard, and immediately came up with that intro pad that ended up being like one of the core elements of Know You. We looked at each other and we were like, let's make a new song out of this. Like, let's... Like, Dreamer's good. It doesn't need anything else. But this could be a whole new song. So then, copied it over to a new session, looped that out, had the chord progression, and I made this very, like, tribal drum beat with a bunch of, like, plucky synths and, like, intense bass, and then he was just singing into a crappy mic, and the whole song happened in one night, the first version of it. But it sounds way different. You'll hear right here. Lot of toms. After dark, we close the bar. He was singing into the microphone that came with my microcord, like vocoder, so it sounds terrible. But we were just demoing it out. You hear it right there. Right? And then we dropped out for the hook, and it turned into this build. Another part we wrote the first day working on this is that guitar part. That's me on my Fender Strat. Crazy drum fill. And then it had a drop. And so this is actually the version we toured off for like most of 2019. We were playing with Still Woozy and Omar and Rios. We would play this in our set. And that's basically the whole thing. You get the verse 2 exact same format. Drop out here with some guitars. Just big. Just a bunch of synths. I think I was playing my microcork on that, which sounds terrible in retrospect. Simpler times. And then a bunch of Arturia synths as well. This new version came as we were getting ready to tour and we wanted a cleaner mix of it. Pretty much the same, but this was actually the session where we got final vocals. So this is all the final vocals happened like the second or third time we worked on the song. And they were actually recorded originally to be doubles and harmonies for his vocal chain for the live set. And we ended up using them as the main vocals. The next version came in spring. And this is an interesting hybrid of the two versions because you actually see that intro, weird arp. But then you have these keys that are also in the final version. But this is like a ballad, basically. Super long intro. connecting the show y'all this far. Made it very punk for a second. So in that version, what was added that we liked and ended up keeping was, sounds like we cleaned up that vocoder, like synth pad. That's kind of like one of the main elements. And that got a lot more showtime in that version. And we also added that FM synthesizer. I think it was a synclavier from Arturia. And then the version after that, you finally get the drums that you're used to. We'll unpack these in a second. Just straight in. I forgot about that part. It's got so many different transitional arcs that got added, some got taken away. And this is kind of like the first glimmer of the actual version that we have now. Yep. In this version, we also added guitar, so that's me on the strap again, doing like a fake bass line, basically. After that, finally got the guitar solo. Between the two, that ended up getting cut out like a week before we submitted to, or like the day before we submitted it to mix, was like that middle section stayed in towards the end. And I really liked it, it had a lot of ear candy, but we ended up feeling like it was a lot tighter by cutting that out and going straight into verse two. This one actually had two guitars on the end, which we ended up deciding to just leave it at the intro. This was also the session where we had the outro, the bridge, something new, something that we found. You can hear acoustics in there. So this is starting to look like the real version. But another important addition of the song, and this is one of the final ones. So we have two more additions. In this addition, I have a Prophet pad that I was playing with a lot. It's like kind of screaming. And this was my first time using it, because we had our headline show and we wanted to make an intro for it. This was back in May of 2019. It was kind of this like epic big intro that we ended up going back to the original intro, but I want to show it to y'all because it's cool. That pad ended up getting featured a couple more times in the song and also all over the record that we've been working on over the past year. So it ended up becoming an important Dream Boy sound, but it did get cut out from its original place, which was the intro to Know You. Last thing I want to mention is I had a kind of playground session by myself when Zach was out of town. This led to another important element. So up until now, the bass had just been 808s. Well, the original versions had that like kind of 80s like da-da-da-da-da-da-da type of like synth bass. And then the version that we're familiar with today was all 808s all the way through. Up until one night in October last fall, I was playing with it and I was like, let me try like doubling this guitar part. This is a different sounding version of the second half of the song, but summer school. It ended up being an element that we used throughout a lot of the song and added a lot to the dynamic and the general groove of it. So yeah, those are all the different versions we had up until the version we landed on and ended up refining, that ended up being the version that got released. I'll start off with the drums because those are the easiest. We have a Big White Beats kick, absolute brick. Some weird stuff going on with the EQ, ton of low end, no high end. So we have that going. Just four on the floor, simple. This is the most complicated part of the drums, is the snare stack. I mean, I like to layer a bunch of sounds, so I'll make a drum rack in Ableton and then just try different combinations of them and eventually land on something nice. Looking at the EQ, we have basic snare drum EQ, taking the harshness out of it, giving it a little bit more body. And then I just kind of brought it in. It was super wide at first, so I brought it in, made it a little bit more narrow. But this snare is consisted of a couple different sounds. So you have really just like simple, straightforward synthetic snare. A weird percussion noise. Yeah, there you go. A little boop. It's only on the first of every measure, every two measures. And then this is kind of like a hat, which is nice. Another kind of like rim shotty sound. And then this is like more of a clap to give it more of like a flam. But then my favorite part right there, it's this hi-hat that is going through LFO tool, which is basically a tremolo. And that's, I like doing that a lot of the time instead of a hi-hat roll, because I feel like it's, when you reverse like a hi-hat and then cut it up, you get a lot different types of accents and whatnot. It just, it feels a lot better than it's like an actual trap, like hi-hat roll. The why that is in the snare bus instead of the hi-hat bus, I don't know. But God works in mysterious ways. Hi-hats are literally just some eighth notes. 1, 2, 3, 4. And that's the whole drum bus right there. For the intro, at least. That's also what happens on pre-chorus. On the choruses, too. Except you get a couple more elements there. You have this tambourine hit that happens a couple times, the top of both choruses, and then also at the top of the bridge at the very end of the song. Valhalla shimmer on that guy, which is nice. It just kind of creates this like noise pad out of it. I want to zone in on here is this clap that you hear in the verses, and then it's also going to be under the snares in the, like the bigger section, so in the choruses and the outro. It's so the way I made this was I created a new session, bounced the song out, played it really low on the speakers, and then I just walked around the room, just clapping from all different angles of the room. And I think I ended up with like over 120 tracks of me clapping. This is 8 bars, and then I'll cut it, bring it back under 8 bars, cut it again. Did a little bit of reverb, panning, EQ, compression, whatever. After dark, we close the... And that's all printed together. And I love that. Maybe it's my hands are big and fat or something, but some of my favorite clap samples have come, and snap samples have come just from like putting the mic in the room and just like getting a bunch, layering them. Real easy, and you can kind of... Like I like the diversity of it, where you can tell it's not a sample that's just being looped, but it actually sounds like a crowd like clapping, and I feel like that adds a lot of humanness to it. Because if we go back, I don't want to pull it up again. The earlier versions, I literally have like a synthetic like clap going throughout the verses when we made the decision to do this format this way, and I think it added a lot having a more organic clap on there. All right, the last thing in the drum section ended up not even being a percussion element. I'll show you what it sounds like soloed. So it's this sample I have called Kanye Reverse. I play it without the time warp, it sounds like this. Sounds kind of like a reverse clap or just like a reverse noise sweep. But then I threw vocal synth on it and I punched in that last chord. I think it's a C minor that is on those turnarounds. And in vocal synth, I'm mapping the mix. So it starts out pretty much completely wet and then goes a little bit drier. So you get a little bit of that sizzle and sparkle coming in towards the end of the tail. That's really nice. That's going into the choruses. On the intro, we have a bass reverse. It's just like a sub swell. And then we have that live bass I was telling you about earlier with a pick. I love using a pick on my E-bass because I feel like it gives, I don't know, I'm originally a guitarist, so I'm used to playing that way, but I feel like it just, from a mixing production standpoint, a lot of the stuff I make, like, I really like having that attack and that drive, and like the bass is its own instrument. It's not just something that's felt, it's something that you're hearing too. But then going into the verses and the pre-choruses, we're just using an 808. And that's hitting just on these downbeats. But then going to the pre-chorus, it picks up, it hits every chord. So that bass pattern basically repeats. One other thing in the bass is at the top of the chorus, we have a more... I can't hear that. My sub's not turned on. But you feel that when you're listening on a system that has sub. It's just like a... like right when the chorus drops. And then this is back. So we kind of build up momentum in verse 2. Or sorry, pre-chorus 2. Verse 2 is pretty much the exact same instrumental. But then bringing that E-bass this time. And I felt like I could get away with that because we were actually doing a down chorus on the second chorus first. Where all the bass drops out, so I felt like I could get away with going 100% on the bass and then dropping out because the next section is down and then comes back in and feels good again. And that just rides us out to the very end. And I just punch that in, it'll boom, slide down. Great way to end a song. So this is that lead part from the very beginning. Literally, what we did to make this was, it was that ooh I was telling you about earlier. That's from Dreamer, the first album. And it's like ooh, but then getting reversed. Ooh. And that's the ooh, 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 ooh. And then I'm literally just running that through Simpler, which is a Ableton basic sampling engine on the keys. And then we just have this LFO that's doing panning. And this stays pretty consistent through the song. In mix, it got turned up and down at various points, but it's in that intro, and then it comes back in on the pre-chorus. Comes in halfway through the first chorus. Next pre-chorus as well. And then just hits for a second during this down section. Just peek back in, get them familiar again with the original beat, and then we slap them with that last chorus. Right here. And I think that Kanye reverse is happening again. Pretty much the exact same thing. Love that. So here's that guitar part I was telling you about. Doing that bass part, but then added this harmony on top of it. That whole group comes back in the next big section in the chorus. Then we also have this, which is me hitting the notes of that old, like, 80s strummy guitar part we had in some earlier versions of the song. Wanted to do them, love them, but wanted them a little bit softer. And this is all on my Strat. I also play Dan Electro and love it. This is the guitar solo on the intro. Very like bendy, and like getting this in time was the biggest nightmare. It's just like a little bit of delay on there. So it's going into the Good Hertz Wolf compressor. It's actually a pretty simple tone, it looks like. Just a little bit of compression, and then one of my favorite amps is Rock Rack from Plugin Alliance. And it has it's the simplest amp ever, but it just it's very convincing. That besides that, UAD amps are also another favorite. But amp simulators are hard to come by. That sound convincing. A lot of them sound like trash. So like there are a lot of songs where I'll just try to get a good DI tone and just call it a day. It's just an octave up. And these are just getting sent to some reverb, Valhalla Vintage. And then a H delay going into the Valhalla room. And then we have some stuff going to chorus as well. This is a free chorus plugin. It's pretty good. It's an emulation of the chorus they have on the Juno. Highly recommend getting it. Here you'll hear that doubled strummy 80s thing. I'm having this doubled with the real ADT. Love this plugin. And then it sounds like I have a clean tone going through. The OTT. One of the goofiest multiband compressors, but I love it, especially on guitars and bass. And this is a slightly crunched up little Rock Rack amp action again. And that's just getting doubled, so that's going to be on each side. I like to listen to that with the plucked version soloed as well. Got here right here. You get the like the human strummy like rhythm of the guitar on that top layer, and that's brighter, but then underneath it, I'm just emphasizing the notes I really want you to hear. Bum 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 bum. With just like some pretty basic plucks. That's a fun trick I like to use for like huge guitar sounds. So on that guitar solo track, later we have this happening. Which is the upper harmony of just like the chord progression. It's like squealing. I love it. It really sends these choruses to the next level. Here's all the guitars together. Bring that harmony in. Stay on the four, down to the three. The harmony. And then this happens during verse two, it's just chords. Take your mom and love the pool. But then things get a little bit different for the outro, so I came up with this guitar part when we were touring off this new version, and I didn't really have anything to play because originally we just had this being like an acoustic guitar section. So I just started hitting that root note and then kind of came up with this melody during a rehearsal once, and we were like, ooh, we should put that in the song. You see I'm running real ADT on that to double it as well. Probably the same amp plugins and the same compression parameters on that good hertz Wolf compressor. But then real quick, you also have the acoustic guitar bus. I'm going to skip to the bottom. This is my dad's Gibson he gave me a couple years back. Seems like I did four takes of it. Hard panned on the outsides. And then there's just like a SSL comp on there from Waves. That's a nice little stereo compression. And some Pultex. Sucking out that like 1.5K to make the acoustics like just a little less harsh. And then we're actually attenuating the high end and the low end. That's interesting. They're so bright, and the mic I record them on is so bright that it seems like I had to pull out some high end on these. Yeah, so if you mute the vocals right there, it's just that lead guitar hitting those notes, acoustic, bass and drums. And then also you get that squealing prophet synth. We'll talk about that in a minute. So before I get into like the weird synthesis stuff, I want to talk about this keypad I created. It's three layers. It's really two layers, but it appears to be three. At the bottom, so like providing more of the body, and it has like pretty much no attack. We just have this Juno emulator. It's just one of their presets called Softness. I'm a big preset guy. Not ashamed to admit it. But then on top of that, we have the Synclavier FM8 like e-piano sound from Analog Lab. And what I did here, so I'm always trying to find like clever ways to widen a sound, because you could throw a chorus on something all day, but eventually just like the middle of the mix is going to cave in. Your song's going to be so wide that it's like width is a source of dynamic. It's not necessarily something you want throughout the whole song. So I kind of wanted to meet in the middle, try something new. So I played the chords, but then I split them up. So you can see here, it's really, you can see both of my hands basically playing a chord and then extensions on top of it. And I did every other, muted on one track and then inverted that on the other one. So in the left, like a half the notes are in there, and then the other half are in this on the right. I was really happy with how that turned out, and then throwing the Juno underneath it has that really nice warmth to it. So this is a part that's going pretty much through the whole song. It's on the intro. It's like the main thing, music thing you hear during the verses. It's under the pre-chorus. On the first chorus, we took out the FM8 like belly piano, and it was just Juno. You can't really hear it in the mix, but it fills out that mid-range nice. It's not hurting anybody. We're back to normal keys. And then here, cut out the bells, because those were more upper register, and we really wanted to push through his ooh group. That was like, ooh, I don't... the BGVs. So we cut them out here, bring them back in on the down chorus. Then take them out because the bass starts creeping out here. Then the low end was getting a little muddy, so cut out the Juno for the rest of the song, and we just had the bells happening on this chorus. That's it for the keys. They get sucked out on the outro. They were too much for the acoustics. So this is a massive, massive patch. And I think it's just a noise sweep. Literally just using massive for its noise. And then love this plugin so much. Kind of like an emulation of like the rat pedals, fuzz. Hear this without it. And back on again. And RC20, this is like a really interesting like flutter, but not like a melodic flutter, like an audio flutter. The magnetic preset or whatever console within RC20. It adds like this like fuzziness to it. Can't really put my finger on it, but it's so nice. It's so random and spazzy, and we love it.
Hi, you want to be in the video?
Everyone say hi, Mimu. This is my baby. All right, let's talk about this sound real quick. We have a prophet running into the Good Hertz Wow control, which is a vibrato. That's giving it a little bit of oscillation. Your basic saturation from Ableton, and then that UAD raw pedal again. It's getting filtered off a lot on both ends just with the basic EQ. And I believe RC20 is adding that magnetic feeling again. This originally was that big pad we had in the intro in a prior version. We ended up killing that. But that added little sprinkles throughout. So you hear it do this like bend up going into the first chorus. And then it comes back in during this like down chorus. And one of them's a bass. This was the original intro. We end up shifting it over and using it for this bridge section. So it's a low end part. Acting as like the bass here. And then we have a high end part. Then we have that noise sweep again. And the last little moment these come back in is during the outro. This is one of the squealing synth leads. It's way up there. I was just kind of jamming. Love that sound. It's the most. It is so extra. Let's talk about the vocals. There are a ton of vocals in this song. Start with the intro. We're fading in this pitched up version of him saying something from the end bridge. And that is just dry. I had some reverb on it in a different session that got printed down. Let's unpack what this is. So I'm running the Vocal Synth, Vocoder, Planet Galaxy preset right here. Let's take that off and see what this sound is. It could be hilarious. I think that's Zach. Yeah, that's Zach saying something. I pulled it from somewhere in the song and I just vocoded it to hell and back to make this pad. As far as automation goes, it's getting pushed up in saturation a little bit. And then this is funky. So there's this preset from Ableton that is called Vocal O. I think it's made to make your audio sound like it's saying O, like a formant type of situation. And I'm slowly moving the scale, which is like the mix basically, from 0 to 100. If we turn that off, I'll show you what it sounds like. And a lot of this is like more experimentation than actual like tried and true practices that I do. Basically the core philosophy behind all this is just you wanting things to be changing and evolving. And it's, for me, it's more than a volume, than volume coming up. It's more of like a, like, make it sound weird, make it sound different, and I find it so much more captivating to the ear. And then we jump right into verse one. We have a lead.
After dark, we close the bar, I lost my phone.
And then we have a double. That's getting a little bit of reverb. And I used Wave's doubler on it. It was the second take he did. I love like keeping the lead vocal pretty dry, but then having a double that's like really kind of washed out, like almost as loud. It's like a decibel quieter. I feel like it gives you a lot of clarity right in the middle of what the singer's saying, but then you can create this whole world of texture around them with their voice, make it sound huge without washing it out. So pre-chorus one, we open up with a couple more doubles.
I don't know you.
Same effect, like doubled out wide, a little bit of room ambient reverb on them. I think I was using Valhalla Room, one of the ambient presets. Doesn't add a whole lot of tail or anything, it just kind of softens up the sound. And then here we have this vocal stack coming in of oohs. Zach did a bunch of oohs, and then we also pitched them around and made them kind of sound childish.
Ooh.
We have his root. And that's pitched up an octave. And it's pitched down an octave. Another root. Another octave. Down an octave. And then we have a harmony come in the second time he hits it right here. Beautiful. Those hit again on the chorus. But just the high ones. We take out his regular voice and we take out the octave low. But then he resolves it. So it was actually a different take. Then in here we also have him saying, hoping everything go right. This is a double that's a little, that's instead of like the reverb washed out, it's a little bit more filtered and telephone vocal effect. Punchy. And then there's his lead. So if you hear all those together, it's great on its own. Hoping everything go right. Hoping everything go right. Hoping everything go right. I was keeping up with you. Same exact drill vocally on verse 2. The only difference is we have these harmonies that sneak in at the very end of it. I think he went up an octave in his falsetto, and then he also added a third harmony on top of it, just in his head voice. Kind of yelly, but we turned it way down. You can barely hear it. Adds a little something, though, you know. Same drill happens here on the pre-chorus. Except this time we did the harmony on the ooze both times. That's all that changed. It's a little interesting on this down section. So we introduce this, which at first sounds like it's just another one of the oohs that's getting pitched up. But it's actually him singing them falsetto, and then we form it, shifted it down a little bit with a little altar boy. It also might have been Isotope Nectar. It was one of the two, but they both do a great job with that. So this, I took a lot of pride in this. When he says, hoping everything goes right, it goes from left to right in the headphones and the speakers. I'm a huge fan of auto pan, especially for like weird moments that only happen once or twice. Hoping everything go right. Hoping everything go right. Hoping everything go right. Because I feel like it adds a distinguished like dimension to the song. And we just have his whole vocal pad coming right here. Hoping everything go right. Hoping everything go right. Hoping everything go right. And then we have this vocoder. So I actually sing this part when we play live. It's just his lead hook part going through vocal synth. It's that same preset, just a vocoder with the Planet Galaxy parameter. And it just works great for me. And I know the audio continues, but the MIDI doesn't. So there's actually no vocoder throughout here. We can get rid of all that. And then the outro vocals. You have the ooze still continuing, but they're quieter. But this comes back in, which was teased at the intro. And it's a chop that chopped up, pitched up version of this part. Something that we found. Then we have a formant shifted down. Way quiet in the mix underneath it. He's doing four takes of those. We just have a little auto tune, a little de-esser, a little Arvox compressor, just getting the job done. Something real, something new, something that we found. And then I took out a little bit of like, it's like 250 and like 500, 460, 220 on the EQ. Something then right here. Little vocoder punching at the end. Something that we found. And that's the whole song. Thank you for watching. If you have any questions, put them in the comments. I will do my best to answer them. Or just shoot me a DM. My Instagram is @aboynamedbobby. And hopefully you enjoyed this. See you next time.